Canberra, Australia, February of 1991. The 7th General Assembly of the World Council of Churches. A rock music concert by Aboriginals in the Assembly's worship tent. In this same tent, Orthodox ecumenists celebrated the Divine Liturgy. The Aboriginal rituals held in the assembly tent included pagan elements. They were not simply a folkloric or cultural presentation. They expressed the pagan foundation of Aboriginal civilization. This assembly is a milestone for the World Council of Churches. The Holy Spirit was blasphemed. Pagan, pantheistic, and animistic ideas were preached. And even our Lord was blasphemed.
Come, the spirit of Amazon rainforest now being murdered every day.
The Korean Presbyterian theologian Dr. Chung Hyung Kyung, together with all the spirits of creation, invoked the spirit of the liberator, our brother Jesus.
Come, the spirit of the liberator, our brother Jesus.
The presence of people of other religions at the assembly is clearly evident. Hindus, Buddhists, Jews, Muslims, and others.
Dr. Anatan Rambachan, Hindu.
Pachatangeditabhuvin.
Vidale Mahinda, Buddhist.
Not only were they welcomed, but they even took an active part in the proceedings.
Religious unity is especially important since it enables to establish a peaceful world.
Of their ancient cultures,
paganism, blasphemies, heathens.
But when churches in the North and West appropriate the consumerism, militarism, and paternalism of our cultures, we speak of theology.
And yet, the Orthodox ecumenists still remain organic members of a pan-heretical Protestant organization.
We have been listening to you for,
and they are the objects of the aggressive challenges of the third world theology of Dr. Chung, who does not hesitate to declare, Buddhism and shamanism are my mother, and my father is Christianity.
Yes. We are dangerous, but in that danger, there is a work of the Holy Spirit.
Such, unfortunately, is the fall of the Protestants, a fall in which the Orthodox are taking part.
Thank you, Dr. Chung.
Meanwhile, the Orthodox ecumenists have drawn even closer to the Roman Catholics. How is this justified? Do the Roman Catholics perhaps have a different attitude towards other religions? Until about the middle of our century, the papacy was confined to a condition of isolation and monologue. An historical landmark is the Second Vatican Council, 1962 to 1965, which led to a spectacular openness not only to other Christians, but also to other religions. the chief inspirer of this policy of openness, Pope Paul VI, on Pentecost 1964, established the office of the Holy See for non-Christians for the expansion of the interreligious vision. The politics of this policy of openness are expressed quite characteristically in the so-called apostolic journeys of the Pope throughout the world. The many impressive trips of the popes to the five continents, which were initiated immediately after Vatican II by Pope Paul VI, as well as the presence of Roman Catholics in non-Christian countries, posed the burning question of culture. How can the gospel be incorporated into, how will it gain a foothold in, and how will it be applied to the cultures of various peoples? Whatever the case, this process presents a danger with regard to the integrity of the Christian faith. Has Roman Catholicism succeeded in avoiding this danger? Unfortunately, Roman Catholicism has acknowledged the possibility of enriching Christianity by different cultures. But is it possible for Christianity to be enriched by different cultures, which are human products marked by sin, and especially cultures which are indissolubly tied to pagan, pantheistic, and animistic elements? It is clear then that Roman Catholicism, by means of a cultural theology, has accepted a new refined syncretism.
God is present in the very heart of human cultures because he is present in man who is created.
But what is the practical consequence of this new Roman Catholic theology? Elements of local cultures, which were built without Christ, have already entered into churches and have adulterated the spirituality of Christian worship. The Pope, in essence, preaches the insufficiency of the salvation in Christ, since he finds answers in the writings of the Hindu Mahatma Gandhi.
I followed the works and the writings of Mahatma Gandhi. I found answers to me, answers to the Christians everywhere, fundamental answers.
India has so much to offer to the world in the task of understanding man and the truth of his existence.
Oddly, the Pope forgets the renewal of all things in Christ Jesus and the deification of man in Christ. He has discovered that India and Gandhi offer a new vision, man as worshipper of an impersonal absolute through self-realization. Can it be that Roman Catholics wish Christianity to be enriched by such purely Hindu beliefs?
And what she offers specifically is a noble spiritual vision of man, man a pilgrim of the absolute. Did not Mahatma Gandhi put it this way? What I want to achieve, what I have been striving and pining to achieve, is self-realization, to see God face to face.
The Roman Catholic theology of culture leads to an affirmation of other religions. In 1985, in Casablanca, Morocco, in front of 80,000 young Muslims, the Pope sanctioned the dialogue with Islam and assured the Muslims that we have the same God. On his trips throughout the world, the Pope pays visits to the leaders of the local religions and expresses his respect for them and for their religions. On what do the Roman Catholics base this affirmation of theirs regarding other religions? The Church, they contend, is the usual and chief path of salvation. The non-Christian religions are other paths of revelation and salvation. They all lead to the common God, to the common Father. Cultural theology and the syncretistic views of other religions have prepared the ground for a new theology of global peace and the creation of a new civilization through the cooperation of the world's religions.
And the heritage of Mahatma Gandhi speaks to us still. And today, as a pilgrim of peace, I have come here to pay homage to Mahatma Gandhi, hero of humanity. Mahatma Gandhi told that if all men and women, whatever the differences between them, cling to the truth with respect for the unique dignity of every human being, a new world order, a civilization of love can be achieved. May God guide us and bless us as we strive to walk together hand in hand and build together a world of peace. Mahatma Gandhi Ji Amarachen. May Gandhi live forever. Satyahinsa Amarache. May truth and nonviolence live forever.
The openness of the Vatican to other religions for mutual knowledge and mutual enrichment is being steadily expanded.
Pope John Paul and the Dalai Lama.
Rapprochement and the exchange of gifts and ideas are the first stage. What is the next stage? At the initiative of Pope John Paul II, on October the 27th, 1986, in Assisi, Italy, the first meeting of religions for the peace of the world took place. 150 representatives from 12 religions took part. Also present were the four great worldwide interreligious organizations: the Interreligious Association for Religious Freedom, the World Congress of Faith, the Temple of Understanding, and the World Conference on Religion and Peace. Present were Buddhists, Muslims, Aboriginals from Africa and America, Zoroastrians, Sikhs, Hindus, and Shintoists. Also present was Elio Toaff, chief rabbi of the Central Synagogue of Rome, which the Pope had visited a few months previously. Christians of almost all confessions were represented: the World Council of Churches, Nestorians, Non-Chalcedonians, Copts, Armenians, Malabarese, Roman Catholics, Old Catholics, Anglicans, Lutherans. Unfortunately, there was also a place at this pan-religious meeting for the Orthodox ecumenists, who indeed played a decisive role in its realization. There were delegates from the Orthodox churches of Finland and Czechoslovakia, the Patriarchate of Bulgaria, the Patriarchate of Romania, the Patriarchate of Georgia, the Patriarchate of Moscow, and the Patriarchate of Antioch. A special place next to the Pope was occupied by Archbishop Runcie, the presiding bishop of the Anglicans, and Archbishop Methodius of Thyatira, the representative of the Patriarchate of Constantinople. The churches of Alexandria and Jerusalem declared their spiritual assent with messages. The Church of Greece, unfortunately, participated in a prayerful way with a well-known Byzantine choir from Athens, which chanted at the three main presentations at Assisi. Pope was the only speaker. In his address, he equated the prayer of Christians to the true and only God with the prayer of all other religions.
It is the result of prayer.
Peace, he emphasized, is a fruit of prayer, which in the various religions expresses a relationship with a supreme power. The Pope's speech was followed by silent prayer, joint prayer. To those of other religions were assigned Christian churches to perform their worship services and to pray for peace. The Buddhists prayed in the parish church of St. Peter. They placed a small statue of Buddha on the altar. The Hindus assembled in the church of Santa Maria Maggiore. Sitting around the sanctuary, they invoked the whole succession of their gods. The Muslims gathered in the monastery of St. Anthony. The aboriginals of Africa prayed in the church of St. Gregory and prepared their peace pipes inside the sanctuary. The Shintoists were assigned to the Benedictine monastery. This was truly a great fall for the Orthodox Ecumenists. They were put on an equal level with the whole spectrum of Christian heresies and with the non-Christian religions. our spotless orthodoxy was indescribably humiliated through these Orthodox ecumenists. The ecumenist journey, which began in 1920 with a proclamation of cooperation and with the hobnobbing of Orthodox and Heterodox, has ended up in joint prayers with heathens to the supposed common father.
We are in fact here together to pray, and for no other reason than to pray.
Where further, we wonder, will this journey of apostasy lead? In Assisi, the establishment of a World Council of Religions was proposed, analogous to the United Nations organization, an organization which would be distinguished by its moral influence in matters of world peace and justice. Is it possible that God should have heard these theatrical prayers and granted peace to the world? It was Christians who, unfortunately, closed the pan-religious service of joint prayer. Concluded this prayer to this supposed common father with the Our Father. This way, the Pope underscored his leading role in the worldwide syncretistic movement towards the pan-religion of the New Age. This was truly a great fall for the Orthodox ecumenists. But unfortunately, it was not the last. Within a year, in December of 1987, Patriarch Demetrius prayed at the Vatican in a fully official way with Pope John Paul II, the instigator and leader of the Babylon of Assisi. Since 1986, the Vatican has continued its effort towards the ecumenical cooperation of religions. Every year, the Roman Catholics organize a similar interreligious meeting in different cities in Europe. In Rome in 1987 and 1988. In Warsaw in 1989. In Bari in 1990. And in Malta in 1991. In 1992, the meeting took place in Brussels. Unfortunately, the presence of Orthodox ecumenists is always strongly evident. They steadfastly follow the Roman Catholics in their interreligious openness. The seventh meeting of religions took place in Milan in 1993. At the famous La Scala of Milan, the start of the proceedings was announced by Mikhail Gorbachev, former president of the Soviet Union, who was also the main speaker. 300 representatives of 42 religions from the whole world took part. On the final day, there was a march for peace in the Cathedral Square of Milan. Thousands of people demonstrated their enthusiasm. In 1994, the eighth meeting was held, again in Assisi. How was it that the Orthodox ecumenists yet again took part in this global apostasy? How could they place our holy faith on the same level as heresies and the other religions of the world? Would the apostles have agreed to Orthodox membership in a pan-heretical and pan-religious organization as members of equal standing? Would they have agreed to cooperate with heretics and heathens for the peace and security of the world?
Gente a cui tornare per rinsaldare l'ispirazione, i cui protagonisti hanno imparato ad incontrarsi
the idea of cooperation of religions has been wholly implanted. But where is this hobnobbing of Christians and heathens leading? The truth is being relativized. The new world order, the new global spirituality, and the new global ethic are already taking flesh and bones.
La lingua dell'amore, pronto a sottolineare soprattutto ciò che unisce. E cosa può unirci oggi? Questo è lo spirito di Assisi.
The Roman Catholic Cardinal Edward Cassidy has underlined what it is that chiefly unites religions.
At Assisi in San Francesco,
and this is the spirit of Assisi.
Tutti possono trovare un ispiratore antico e nuovo.
13 settembre 1994.
But what is the spirit of Assisi? The lights of all religions must be united together so that the world may be enlightened. What place does the unique light of the world, our Lord Jesus Christ, have in this syncretistic union? What communion hath light with darkness?